word as if he were a fable. They taunt my faith and scorn me as if I were a fool. That all their slandering doesn't change a thing, or even that this very hour, if the Father pleases, he shall bow and the crowds increase with those who sin and yet seem to prevail. But saints fight the faithful fight, and soon wrong will be made right, and every suffering sacrifice for the cause of Christ will be rewarded on that day, when at the name of Jesus he shall bow and adore, and nations kneel down before him, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. And kings shall bow and adore, and nations kneel down before him, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Turning to Bibles this evening to the book of Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. By the way, we will be here tomorrow evening, maybe not Sunday morning. The best thing you can do is give us a call to see exactly what goes on, but it looks pretty bad. Let's take a moment of silent prayer as we normally do to give us the opportunity to enter into fellowship with God, naming and citing any known sins, if we have any. And again, if there's something that might be troubling you or disturbing to you, now's not the time to concentrate on any of your problems, but now's the time to give your undivided attention to the Word of God as it is being spoken. Therefore, with that in mind, let us pray. Thank you, Father, again for the privilege of gathering together with members of the royal family. to continue to grow in your grace and in your knowledge and have these things made available to us so that we can execute that plan that you have designed for us from eternity past. We pray for your blessing to be upon this evening's message and all that we'll be noting. In the name of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. If you were here last evening, excuse me for that. I'd like to try to cover that up. If you were here last evening, we finished point six, and this leads us to our seventh point in the doctrine of enemyship, which is point seven. This has a lot to do with the carnal believer, because the carnal believer now has more application to us than the third and fourth and fifth and sixth point that we've studied. The carnal believer, according to the Bible, becomes a temporary enemy of God by being on a fellowship. The key word, of course, right here is the word temporary, but we do lose out on having God's highest and best if we stay in the realm of carnality. Romans chapter 8, let's begin with verse 6. It says, "For the mind or the mental attitude set on the flesh is death." For the mind or the mental attitude set on the flesh is death. But the mind set on the spirit is life and peace. Actually, let me give you the correct Greek word order there. We would say in the English, if we were to put the words in order, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. And that is the key, by the way, when it comes to carnality. People think carnality is just some form of immoral sin or some overt sin. But you can be a very, very moral, sweet, kind individual and still be carnally minded. Now, that means that you become an enemy of God because you're lacking that one mind that only God will accept, which of course is the mind of Christ. So Paul goes on to say, because the mind, verse 7, set on the flesh, the carnal mind, notice this, is hostile toward God. That means, in spite of what you may think, in spite of how you may observe other members of the royal family of God or other believers, if they're not thinking divine viewpoint, their mind is hostile toward God. They are enemies of God. Why? Verse 7, the mindset on the flesh, the carnal mind, is hostile toward God, for it does not subject itself to the law of God or the doctrines of God. And it can't subject itself to the laws of God or the doctrines of God. Why? Because it doesn't know the laws or the doctrines of God. The natural-minded man cannot understand the things of the Spirit of God. So because the mindset on the flesh, the carnal mind, is hostile toward God, for it does not subject itself to the law of God, for it is not even able to do so. And then verse 8, we've studied this in some detail when we looked at the doctrine of the old sin nature. Those who are in the flesh, those who are out of fellowship with God, by the way, those who are in the flesh, the good people, the moral people, the sweet person, the churchgoer. Of course, we don't have to say that this is the immoral person. That's just something that everybody accepts. But when it says those who are in the flesh, it's a reference to those living in the Adamic nature. And then it says they cannot please God. So notice again, the carnally minded person in verse 6, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because in verse 7, the carnal mind is hostile toward God. Now, what is carnality? Well, first of all, carnality is an absolute. What do I mean by that? In other words, you are either spiritual or carnal. Right now, every one of you listening to my voice, you're either spiritual or carnal. You can't be half spiritual and half carnal, or 80% spiritual or 20% carnal. Carnality is an absolute which describes the believer out of fellowship with God and in a state of sin under the control of his old sin nature. That's Romans chapter 7. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 3. This evening, we're going to be looking at two individuals. One was carnal, and he was an enemy of God, and God dealt with him in a certain way. The other was a reversionist, and God killed him, as we will see with our next point. But again, carnality is an absolute. It describes the believer out of fellowship with God and in a state of sin under the control of the old sin nature. And by the way, the carnal believer can even be positive to doctrine. The carnal believer can be faithful to the use of the rebound technique. The carnal believer can come to a point in their lives where they never lose interest in doctrine. But what they're doing is that they're holding back themselves from having the highest and best that God wants them to experience, not when they die, but to experience right now in this life. So carnality can exist either temporarily when the believer is even advancing in the predesigned plan of God, or carnality can actually perpetuate until you come to a point, believe it or not, where you no longer think the things of God have any value or meaning. So the believer is in an absolute state. All believers are in an absolute state. The believer is in an absolute state, spiritual or carnal, even while growing, just as he is in an absolute state while declining. You see, you can be carnal and still be growing, but you're going to reap what you sow in the carnal realm, and then that's going to offset what's happening in the spiritual realm with your growth. So the believer is in an absolute state, either spiritual or carnal, while growing just as he is in an absolute state while declining. And therefore, when we do that according to the word of God, we are said to be enemies of God, because the way that we are thinking is hostile toward God. And you can say, praise the Lord, and I'm a Christian, and I love God, and go through all of that nonsense that people go through, and then think that you can live in carnality, and that God thinks that it's all right for you to continue in that realm. Yet that is not what the Word of God teaches. Therefore, carnality can either be a temporary, and here's the danger, or a permanent setback in the execution of God's will, God's purpose, and God's plan for your life. Notice I said it can either be a temporary, because you can always rebound and recover. You can always come back to God. You can always gain that ground that you've lost. And so it can be either a temporary, but unfortunately for many, a permanent setback in the execution of the will of God, the purpose of God, and the plan of God for your life. It all depends on whether or not the believer wants not to just rebound. Remember, we study this in the book of Numbers. Rebound is not enough. It's not just rebound. It's not sinning and rebounding and sinning and rebounding. It is rebounding and recovering. And so the danger, because the danger is that prolonged carnality will compromise the believer's integrity. And that's when it results in reversionism. And the next thing you know, this temporary setback now becomes a permanent setback. I think all of us know people at one time who were positive toward the Word of God, and then they got in some form of carnality temporarily, and the next thing you know, they stayed in it permanently, and now they're no longer interested in the will or the purpose of the plan of God for their lives. Let me show you a passage that Paul uses, by the way, to describe what it means to be carnal. Go to 1 Corinthians 3, verse 1. A little bit of a corrected translation here, but 1 Corinthians 3, 1, Paul is writing to the church at Corinth, by the way. He's writing to an assembly that had nothing but divisions. And he says in verse 1, "And I, brethren, could not speak to you as unto spiritual persons." What is he saying? I could not speak to you as unto believers who were filled with the Spirit. They were not. They were carnal. How do we know that? "I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual persons, but as unto carnal." That means they're fleshly. They were belonging to the sin nature. "I had to speak unto you as carnal, as childish in Christ." They were immature. Now, he says, "I gave you milk." That's basic doctrine. He had to keep on giving them that basic doctrine. "I gave you milk to drink and not solid food." Advanced doctrine, by the way. "For you," notice this, "you were not able to receive it." And then he makes this sad statement, "and you still are not able." You are still not able. In other words, you can't receive it, and even if I teach it, you can't perceive it. Why? Now look what he says in verse 3. for you are still carnal, belonging to the sin nature. You see, they were still carnal. And then he describes the carnality. Here's the carnality. For since there is jealousy and strife among you. Notice they were jealous of one another. There was strife between them. Are you not carnal and you keep walking in conformity with men? That's your corrected translation. Who is he talking to? A group of individuals at Corinth who were fighting with each other, who were jealous. They had strife. They had the mental attitude sins, the sins of the tongue. And even though they gathered together and had a lot of celebration, they were enemies of God. Why? Again, point seven, the carnal believer becomes a temporary enemy of God by being out of fellowship. Romans 8, 7 through 8, 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 3. I say temporary enemy because if they die the sin unto death, they're absent from the body again in face to face with the Lord. Now this brings us to another point that I like to spend some time on as well. And that is the eighth point, which deals with the fact that God is the enemy of the reversionistic believer, 1 Samuel 28, verse 16. We're going to see that. This is a little bit more dangerous. You see, in point seven, the carnal believer, because he is an individual who's not thinking correctly, under point seven, the carnal believer becomes a temporary enemy of God because he's out of fellowship. But under point eight, if the person remains in carnality long enough, then God now begins to become that individual's enemy. That's when the individual becomes really in trouble with the mind of Jesus Christ against him, and then divine discipline comes in. All right, let's go back to 1 Samuel 28 for a moment. Let's begin with verse 1. Here it's very, very dangerous, as you're going to see. One individual had a carnal mind toward God, and he's going to recover. The other individual had became the enemy of God in the sense that God became his enemy as a reversionistic believer. God is the enemy, by the way, of a believer when he is in reversionism, and especially when he's under the sin unto death. We'll see that when we get to 1 Samuel 28, verse 16. However, I want to give you let's begin with a background here, because this is a very interesting passage and it needs some explanation. In verse 1 of 1 Samuel chapter 28, and I discovered some great principles in verses 1 and 2 that really apply to, they apply to all of us, to remind ourselves what happens when we become enemies of God, and what you could do, things that would shock even yourself. In fact, David is about to do something. Look at verse 1 of 1 Samuel 28. It came about in those days that the Philistines gathered their armed camps for war. Notice the Philistines are gathering their armed camps for war. The Philistines were enemies of Israel. And they gathered their armed camps for war to do what? To fight against Israel. And Achish, that's their king, said to David, "Know assuredly that you will go out with me in the camp, you and your men." Now right away, something should strike you. What in the world is David doing with King Achish, who was a king of Israel, who was a king that hated the Jewish people? King Achish led the Philistines, and the Philistines were the Jews' number one arch rivalry. They hated the Jews. And yet, who's on their side right now? King David. What's he doing there? We'll see what he's doing there in just a moment. So the Philistines were the enemies of Israel, and there's going to be a battle that's coming up in the Battle of Gilboa, which was about to take place. Saul, King Saul, will be outsmarted and outthought by King Achish, who was a Philistine. And the principle is, here is an unbelieving Gentile Philistine who is about to defeat a believing Jew. Why? Well, as I mentioned on one of these points when we began the doctrine, I think it was the second point, I mentioned recently, the advancing believer, or the believer who is especially mature, who's in fellowship with God, doesn't have to be concerned with his enemies because of the protection given by God inside of that wall of fire of Zechariah 2, verse 5. That wall of fire of Zechariah 2, verse 5 is equivalent to us living in the church age in the pre-designed plan of God. And you see, if you're advancing, and I use advancing rather than mature, a mature believer, if you are advancing, even as a new believer, there's a protection that God gives you as an advancing believer on your first on the road to your first stage of spiritual growth, or second or third. And you don't have to be concerned with your enemies and what people are secretly trying to do against you, because you have been given a protection by God, because you're inside of that wall of fire. And in the church age, we call that living in the pre-designed plan of God. The issue that we're going to see is that there is not a reason in the world why an unbeliever should ever outsmart a believer. But Saul, like many believers today, is totally ignorant of God's word. He's going to look for some supernatural experience, some magical formula. And as a reversionistic believer, he is way out of line. See, we're going to see in verses 1 and 2, I'll show you in this introduction where we're going, David is carnal, but he's not in reversionism. And when we look at Saul, Saul is a reversionistic believer that is going to cause one of those fortune tellers that you see on television. He's going to see a witch and try to get some advice as to what he should do. That's how far gone he is. And therefore, he's going to seek advice from a witch. She's called the Witch of Endor, by the way. Many Christians, by the way, have their own Witch of Endor. They're called fake healers or miracle workers, or pray that I get out of this situation. But that is not what God has given us to solve our problems. In fact, even prayer, remember, has not been given to us as a problem-solving device. We are not to pray ourselves out of situations. We are to use those problem-solving devices to solve our problem. But we're going to see Saul, a believer who will be defeated by an unbeliever. Why? Because a believer minus doctrine is dumber than an unbeliever. And Saul is minus doctrine. He's a passive, slothful backslider who has neglected the word of God, and he hasn't done it. When we talk about reversionism, Saul hasn't just fallen away like some of you have for maybe 6 months or a year or 2 years. It's been 20 years since Saul has really been in fellowship with God. And God is the one who has now become his enemy. And God's going to kill him. In fact, the reason why he's killed is given to us in the Word of God. Go forward just to 1 Chronicles chapter 10. Go by 2 Samuel, then 1 Kings, 2 Kings, and the next one is 1 Chronicles 10. Let's look at why Saul died. The Bible tells us why Saul died, and there's a whole movement out today. Positive faith movement, all death is from the devil and it's not from God, and God's not the one who brings on sickness and death, and prosperity is what God wants you to have, and if you're living in poverty, you're out of the will of God, etc. All of that stuff is a lot of nonsense, and here's a passage that even disproves what these people teach. 1 Chronicles 10:13. So Saul died. Why? For his trespass which he committed against the Lord. He didn't die for his trespasses or his sins. He died for his trespass which he committed against the Lord, because of the word of the Lord which he did not keep. He rejected the word of the Lord, but also, notice the next part, also because he asked counsel of a medium, making an inquiry of it, and he did not inquire, verse 14, of the Lord. Therefore, he, the Lord, killed him. Who killed Saul? The Lord did. He, the Lord, killed him and turned the kingdom to David, the son of Jesse. I heard a man trying to defend that verse, and he said when it says, therefore, he killed him, that that was the devil. But the problem that he had was the second part, because the same one that killed him turned the kingdom to David, the son of Jesse. This is the Lord killing someone. In fact, 1 Samuel 2, verse 6 says, the Lord kills and the Lord makes alive. So notice why it is that Saul died. In verse 13, two reasons. One, he rejected doctrine. He rejected the word of the Lord, and he rejected it by not keeping it. And secondly, he's now asking counsel of a medium. He's now going to some other form of advice, and of course that advice is coming from the kingdom of darkness. So go back to 1 Samuel 28:1. This is a great passage, because I know about a lot of the principles coming up, and I think they're principles that will give us wisdom if we continue to learn what it is that God would have us to learn, especially from this subject. All right, verse 1 again, it came about that in those days that the Philistines gathered their armed camps for war to fight against Israel. And Achish said to David, know assuredly that you will go out with me in the camp, you and your men. Notice that even David's men, who are Israelites and they are Jews, are now going to go out to battle to kill other Jewish individuals. David, by the way, had been running from King Saul. He got himself, listen to me carefully, he got himself into a jam. And what did he do? Well, he did what most of us do when we get ourselves in a jam. He ended up compromising his doctrine. And now he ended up compromising so much that he got himself in a jam that seems almost impossible to get himself out of. Now he's going to war against his own people. Now look what David said to Achish. I want to show you the hypocrisy, the phonyism here. David said to Achish, very well, you shall know what your servant can do. Isn't that a great answer? In verse 1, Achish said, know assuredly that you will go out with me in the camp, you and your men. Does David say in verse 2, oh, thank you, king. You've been very faithful to me. I'll go out and we will kill the enemy. We will kill those Jews. No, David said to Achish, very well, you shall know what your servant can do. I like that phrase. And so Achish said to David, very well, I will make you my bodyguard for life. Now, when David says, very well, you shall know what your servant can do, this is Operation Strap-On. This is David caught in a real jam, all because he didn't trust in the character, the nature of God to come through for him in God's timing. He didn't trust in the Lord. He took his men to Philistia because he's running away from King Saul. He hired himself out to the enemy. King Achish said, what are you doing here, David, with all of these soldiers? And David said, we would like to hire ourselves out to you, and we will fight for you. And now he's got himself in a big jam. And by the way, this is a picture of what happens to any of God's people who go to the world for help. The Lord said through the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 30 verse 1, woe to the rebellious children, declares the Lord, who execute a plan but not mine. Now think with me for a moment and don't get, excuse me, the heat on? Okay, leave it on. Think with me for a moment and don't get condemned. Don't feel bad. But how many times have you executed your own plan? How many times have I executed my own plan? How many times have we tried to do things our way? And all of a sudden, we find ourselves in a situation, in a jam. We wake up one day and find out we're on the opposite side, and we're even fighting against God's side. Well, the Bible says, woe to the rebellious children, declares the Lord, who execute a plan, but it's not mine. See, they're executing a plan. There's their timing, not God's timing. They make an alliance, but not of my spirit, in order to add sin to sin. That's what David did. He kept on adding sin to sin as a carnal believer. Verse 2 goes on to say, who proceed down to Egypt. And of course, if you've studied typology with me, Egypt represents the world. And so they proceed down to Egypt, down to the cosmos, down to the cosmic system, down to the ways of the world. They proceed down to Egypt without consulting me. Now you may say, well, wait a minute, I had needs. And why haven't these needs been met? Well, perhaps you didn't wait on the divine timing of God, because the Lord said they do this without consulting me. They take refuge in the safety of Pharaoh. Pharaoh is a type of the god of this world, Satan, who controls the world, Egypt, and to seek shelter. Well, I've got a lot more security now. I've got something that I didn't have before. Now they're seeking shelter, protection. Where? With God? No, in the shadow of Egypt, which of course is not protection. It's not a shelter at all. It's just a front for the god of this world, putting God's people in bondage. And then the Lord said in verse 3, therefore, you want to go down to Egypt? You want to go to the ways of the world? The safety of Pharaoh will be your shame, and the shelter in the shadow of Egypt will be your humiliation. You want to rest in the god of this world and the ways of this world? That will be your shame. The shelter in the shadow of Egypt, that will be your humiliation. The point that I want you to see in verse 2, that David is now in a serious jam. He is in a serious jam as a result of his carnality and his previous problems. And it all caught up to him. Now, don't feel bad, because if you've been in a jam like that, the interesting thing is, by the time this chapter is over, David will recover. He'll rebound. He'll recover. He'll be back in fellowship with God, and he'll be the king of Israel, and Saul will be killed. He will be put to death by the Lord. So here is the principle I want you to remember before we go on to verse 3, because someday you're going to face the exact same thing. Some of you have. In fact, I'm trying not to look at some of you, because I know what some of you have gone through, and you can say, and I know you're saying in your heart, amen, I've done that, been there, done that, that's me. And perhaps you can just learn the wisdom of being there and doing that and sharing it personally with others when you have the opportunity. But here's a principle I want you to remember, because someday you're going to face exactly the same thing. When a believer goes negative toward doctrine, here's the key, for a period of time, that's what happened to David, he ends up with hardness of the heart and in reversionism. David's heart was becoming hard. He didn't end up in reversionism like Saul, but he began to even turn against the very people of God. The very man, think about it, the very man, that young teenager who said to Goliath, who are you to defy the armies of the living God? The Lord will fight for me. I will defeat you. Whatever happened to that man, that courageous soldier, that man who said, no one will defy the armies of the living God? The very same one that said that is now fighting against the armies of the living God. His heart has become hard in carnality. He's not in total reversionism yet, but there are areas of his soul we're going to note that he had become hard in. Unfortunately, he's in a jam. We're going to see how Saul, he went from that hard heart, rejection of doctrine, to reversionism, and then ultimately in reversionism, that hardness of heart, the scar tissue of the soul, is something that is very difficult to respond or to recover from. So at this, by the way, if you're ever faced with a time where you have gone negative toward doctrine, I had a friend of mine speak to me just recently, and he was telling me something that he had gone through personally, and he was saying he began to reject and neglect the Word of God, not because of his negative attitude, but because of the fact that he had something that he had to deal with, and I don't want to get into the details, and he is a friend of mine, and he said it's so easy. He began to fall away. He said it's so easy once you get used to not hearing the Word of God. It's so easy to wake up one day and you just you lose that love, that desire, that preciousness. You lose that positive attitude that you've had. And everyone can do that. Anyone can do that who's born again. Because if you go negative toward doctrine for a period of time, you can end up with that hard heart and in reversionism. Now, at this time, two things can happen. Number one, if you recognize it like David did, you can actually, I mean, you can stay, I'm going to give you Saul first. You can be like a Saul. Saul actually stayed in a backslidden state until he dies the sin unto death. That's the first thing you can do. Saul's about to die the sin unto death. And this is what happens when someone recognizes that they are in reversionism. You can end up like Saul, I mean like David, and recover. Or you can stay in that backslidden state until you die the sin unto death. That's King Saul. It all depends on whether or not you're humble enough to recognize I've made a stupid decision. I have screwed up my life. I should have never made this decision. I did it. It's too late. You can't look back at the decision and say, I've got regrets and I shouldn't have done this. It's too late for that. You can't change the past, but you can sure change the present and change the future. So two things can happen to the believer who recognizes that. He can stay in the backslidden state until he dies the sin unto death. Or as we're going to see in this passage, you can rebound and recover as David did. You see, never get to a point where you think it's too late, that you can't rebound and that you can't recover. However, and we're going to see this as well under this point, after you have recovered from making a series, and I'm not talking about sporadic sinning, I'm not talking about sinning and rebounding, but staying with the plan of God, I'm talking about a lifestyle of carnality, and a lifestyle where you end up even in reversionism. After you have recovered, often what you have done in your backslidden state will bounce right back on you and still haunt you. Don't ever think that all you have to do is name and cite your sin and that there's nothing coming after that, that you don't have to deal with any of your problems. I always like to use that illustration, which unfortunately is true in a lot of cases. A girl goes out and commits fornication and she has a baby and she realizes that she has a child out of wedlock. Well, when she rebounds, the child doesn't disintegrate. The child doesn't disappear. She now has that baby and something to deal with for years and years and years. So even though you have recovered, after you have recovered, often what you have done in your backslidden state may still bounce back and haunt you. Sometimes even when a person recovers from his backslidden state, something that happened while he was in that backslidden state can come back and even put him in a jam. But there's always the blessing of recovery. Always remember, no matter how many mistakes you have made, no matter how much you have failed, no matter what sort of jam you have gotten yourself in, always remember, once back in fellowship, God will always provide and deliver you from the jam. That's 1 Corinthians 10:13. Now, you may not like God's means of deliverance, but he will always provide, he will deliver you from that jam in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13. But on the other hand, we'll see this with Saul, because Saul is a believer. In fact, Saul, we're going to find out Saul is a believer in this passage. If a believer does not, rebound and recover, and he remains separated from God in reversionism, well, the consequences of his reversionism is Galatians 7, the B part. Whatever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Saul sowed a lot of negative volition. He's going to reap being put to death by the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is when disaster, heartache, divine discipline, personal suffering, all of these things come into the picture. And unfortunately, a lot of us do not learn this the easy way. By faith, believing what the Bible says, we learn it the hard way through experience. So the backslider or the reversionistic believer reaps what he sows. You see, you can go in that direction. Whereas a believer who has rebounded and recovered reaps what God sows. And you say, well, suppose I have to deal with some jam or something that comes back to haunt me. So be it. But you can still be blessed by God. And this should be taken very seriously as far as all of us are concerned. And this should be a solemn warning, because all of us could testify, if we've been born again and saved for, I'd say, maybe 10 years, that we have made decisions that have come back to haunt us. And we have reaped what we have sown in some areas. And thank God, in most areas, we reap what God has sown. So the next time you find yourself getting indifferent toward the Word of God, remember this principle, because you have that choice of going two ways. Number one, you can reap what you sow in life. Or number two, you can reap what God sows. And it's very possible that there are people right now who are listening to this message who are going to die the sin unto death. Now, I'm not just saying those of you who are here, but anyone who's listening right now, maybe it's through tape or through the video or through radio or through the internet, it's very possible that there are people who listen to this type of message who are going to die the sin unto death, because they didn't pay attention to this principle. That's why you cannot afford to neglect the Word of God even for a moment. Doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter if your life is not together and you've got a domestic problem, you've got a financial problem, a problem with your business, a problem with a family member, a neighbor. It doesn't matter. You can't afford to neglect the Word of God for a moment, nor can I. And you would be shocked again how easy it is to get, not to hate Bible doctrine, it doesn't start like that, not to hate other believers or to hate the communicator or the people of God. You would be shocked how easy it is to get indifferent, apathetic, passive, lifeless, superficial, shallow, and unconcerned, uninterested in the Word of God, even after you have been positive. I'm looking forward, I guess we're not going to do this Sunday because I don't think it's ready anyway, but the following Sunday, I'm looking forward to hearing a report that is being put together about what God has done in the ministry this past year. In fact, I'm looking forward to seeing some of your faces, some of you who have been faithful to this ministry for years, and it's been the greatest year this past year in all of the ministry, in all the times I've ever passed at any local assembly. The finances are better than ever. The support is better than ever. The work is better than ever. I shared this, I think, with people on Tuesday. I'll repeat it again because I'm very proud of all of us working together with the power of God. But it is unheard of to have a ministry take 35% of its income and send it out to outreach ministries. Normally, they want to tithe. They'll say, let's give other ministries 10% or let's just invest 10% in outreaches. And yet 35%, that's over one third. Going to do what? Reaching out to people, getting doctrine out there, getting the gospel out there, having people have videos and tapes, cassette tapes, having them have CDs with the music ministry that George has been sending out, having them have the internet, having them have face-to-face teaching, not charging. How many conferences have you ever been at where they do not charge? They do not charge whatsoever for the conference, and they just allow people to come and then feed the people and help those individuals have a nice place to stay, but just reaching out to people. Don't ever get familiar with that, because if you do, you'll become indifferent. You'll wake up and you'll become apathetic, and you'll be passive and lifeless and superficial and shallow. I was with Ray today, and we were talking about the fact we were on the way to North Providence. I went to see my mom, and on the way to North Providence, I was saying, isn't it great that we've got another pastor in the area, John Ritchie, who's starting a doctrinal church? And Ray said the same thing, that he's going to be able to reach out to people that I could never reach out to. And I was thinking about the fact, isn't it fantastic that we can even help support someone like him or someone like Jim Ricard or whoever else is going to become a pastor, even if it's in your own geographical location. I was talking to Pastor Sykes, and he was telling me about some problems he was having in his denomination. And I said, well, the offer is always there. Come back. And anytime you want to start a church in Providence, we'll be there. We'll help you out. We'll get you started. We'll do everything in our power. You'll be supported by us. And by the way, a lot better than he's being supported right now by his own church. Now, I'm not saying he's going to do that, but he's praying about it, and he seems very serious about it. Now, why didn't I say, I can't have Pastor Sykes come here because he's going to take the Providence people. I can't have John Ritchie, can't support him because he's going to take all the Italian people from me, you see, because he has an Italian restaurant where his church meets, and it still has that garlic smell, and it's probably a lot warmer. Why don't I say no? Yeah, the oven's on. And why don't I say no? Because that's not the heartbeat of this ministry. That's not the attitude that we have. And if we have that type of attitude, you'll be shocked how easy it is to get indifferent and apathetic and become familiar with that and be passive. Because I guarantee you, go and try to find churches in New England that are teaching Bible doctrine and teaching the truth that sets you free. They're very difficult to find. That's why we have people all over the country that are listening through the internet. They've got more churches down their own street than we have in this entire town. But why are they listening? Because they know what it's like to not have what we have, and to have positive volition and individuals working together so that we can have the gospel taught properly and so that we can have doctrine taught properly. They know what it's like to sit in a church and do what some of you are doing, looking at the watch. I think it's 8:44. And they know what that's like. One thing I'd like to do is have a camera planted here, because one of the most exciting things, or things that would really give you laughter, is how people look at their watches. They go like this. Then they go. All of you have different moves. You know, we've got more moves in this church than X-Lax. I mean, we've got a lot of moves in this church, okay? And it's so funny to see some of you look at your watch. I don't care, look at your watch, it won't bother me. Because every time I see someone look at their watch, I go a minute more. So I'm only teasing, but But seriously, you'd be shocked how easy it is to become passive and lifeless and superficial and shallow and unconcerned about the things of God. It doesn't happen overnight. It's that very same principle that I gave you before, that old principle of Satan wearing out and deceiving the saints of God, as he did in Daniel 7:25. He will do that in the tribulation period. He does that right now. He does it gradually, tries to wear us down, especially, as I said, during the holiday season. He does it gradually, invisibly, continually. Little by little, the saints of God are being worn down without even knowing what's happening behind the scenes. Why? Get them away from that excitement. And by the way, if you're not excited if you're not excited and motivated here, then find a church where you can be excited and motivated. But don't ever come to that conclusion that the majority do. I don't need a pastor. I don't need a church. I don't need fellowship with God's people. I don't need to release my giving, and I don't need to operate in my spiritual gift. And that's another thing we'll be dealing with, how people that are not face to face can deal and use their spiritual gift as well, because we have people that listen non-face to face and they're wondering, how can I exercise my spiritual gift? That will be coming up not this Sunday, but the Sunday after. So I want you to notice what David did. Notice in verse 2 that David is in a jam. By the way, and I want you to see this and don't forget it, because a lot of times people don't realize that this can happen. David is a very noble person, but he finds himself doing something contrary to his own conscience. I'll repeat it again. Very simplistic statement, but I think all of us can identify with it. David is a very noble person, just like many of you are. You're a very noble individual. You have character and you have integrity. But David found himself doing something contrary to his own conscience. By his conscience, I mean the norms and standards of his soul. Have you ever found yourself doing something contrary to your own conscience? What's the first reaction that you have? You hate you. You say to yourself, I can't believe I'm doing this. You hate doing it. Why? Because you found you're in a jam. And the easiest way to get out of the jam is for you to do something contrary to your own conscience. So you do it. But you see, you think that's the easiest way. The best way is to do what the Word of God has to say. Give yourself time. It doesn't happen overnight. But do what the Word of God has to say. Be gracious toward yourself and realize that there's always a way out if you're willing to stay with the plan of God. He will provide in His time. You see, David finds himself deceiving a man when David doesn't like deceit. David despises deceit. He wrote an entire psalm, Psalm 55, about hating deceit and hating deception. And the very man that wrote Psalm 55 is now doing the same thing. He finds himself doing the same thing that he despises in others. Have you ever done that? Have you ever found yourself doing the same thing that you despise in others? Why? Well, it's the same reason that David did, because David placed himself in a situation of compromise. He finds himself doing something that he despises in others. Because we find ourselves and we have placed ourselves in a situation of compromise, we find ourselves doing something that we despise in others. David is a very wonderful person. He's a very honorable person. He's a noble person. But backsliding always changes the very character and honesty of an individual. And this, by the way, is also what happened to Saul. You know, Saul was a very honest and noble man. And Saul started, when he started his reign, he was an honest and noble man, but now in reversionism, he has turned into a monster. By the way, what turned Saul into a monster? You know what turned Saul into a monster? Lady singing. That's what turned Saul into a monster. Because one day he heard the ladies singing that Saul has killed his thousands, but David has killed his 10,000s. And ever since Saul heard that, jealousy drove him crazy. Some of you remember Nebuchadnezzar, King Nebuchadnezzar. We studied about him and the disease that he received from jealousy, which is lycanthrope. And we noted that means he actually thought that he was, he went around acting like an animal, acting like a wolf. He didn't think that he was a werewolf, but that's what he acted like an animal. And he was plagued with jealousy. The same thing happened to King Saul. So David finds himself, you know what he's doing? He's finding himself deceiving and lying to a wonderful king like Achish, who helped David out when David had nowhere to go. David went to King Achish and he had nowhere to go, and now he finds himself lying and deceiving this wonderful king like Achish, who had been a good friend to David. Achish had treated David honorably, but David was not honorable and noble in his treatment of Achish. It's interesting to note that Achish, the unbeliever, is honorable, while David, the believer, is dishonorable. I've had many members of our congregation say that there's a lot of unbelievers that they trust more in than believers. Why? Because if a believer is in reversionism or carnality and the unbeliever has norms and standards and morals and values, that unbeliever can be trusted more than the believer. Achish, the unbeliever, is honorable, while David, the believer, is dishonorable. And how do we know that? Look at verse 2. I'll close with this final verse. David said to Achish, David said to Achish, "Very well, you shall know what your servant can do." But what is it that King Achish said? "Well, you know what? You, very well, I will make you my bodyguard for life." And that was a great reward. I'm going to be the bodyguard of the king. Yes, King Achish turned around and said, "You know what, David? I love you and I respect you. And I have so much respect and honor for you that you can be the bodyguard for me for the rest of my life." What's David doing? Look at the beginning of verse 2. He's saying, David said to Achish, "Very well, you shall know what your servant can do." David's selecting his words very carefully, not committing himself to anything, using words as a smoke screen. By the way, beware of the con artist. He comes in all shapes and sizes, colors and ages and genders. He either uses words as a smoke screen, and by the way, many con artists use words, and they'll use words as a smoke screen, or they'll use silence. And yet, here's a man who treated David in a wonderful way, and David's turning around, and he's going to dishonor him in some way, as we will see coming up, even though God is still in control. You're going to find out that this is true in life, by the way, including the Christian way of life. Don't always listen to the words that are coming forth from someone's mouth just because they're a Christian. That's the principle. We've seen it many times. That principle is very simple. One in life that you're going to learn, people are going to tell you one thing and mean something entirely different. That's Proverbs 23:7, a popular verse. "As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. He says to you, eat and drink, but his heart is not with you." But you see, we've got two believers in this passage that we're going to see as we conclude it. The first one is a carnal believer whose mind is at enmity toward God. The second one is a reversionistic believer who now has God as his enemy. The carnal believer is going to recover and come back to God. The reversionistic believer is going to be put to death by the Lord. We'll see more of this as we continue our study tomorrow evening. Father, thank you again for your privilege, the privilege that you've given us to gather together with members of the royal family. We pray that God, the Holy Spirit, would challenge us with many of these principles which we have noted. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.